My name is Rick Hane, and I want to tell you a little bit about what we've learned from this picture. We've learned something from this picture about boosting rural economies and creating sustainable water supply for the most difficult to reach. Now let's have a look at the Sustainable Development Goal number 6, where we have to ensure sustainable water for everybody. And that everybody is going to be a challenge in Africa if you look at population density. If you look at the map here, every country in Africa that is colored green has less than 50 people per square kilometer. If we design a common pump, we assume the pump is going to be used by 250 people, and these people should not travel more than 500 meters to get there. So actually, we're looking at 250 people in less than 1 kilometer, which is somewhere here in the dark purple. And I don't see many countries with that type of population density. Now let's have a look at Zambia specific. And I'm sure that's also for other countries in Africa. The population density is high in the capital and some of the bigger cities. So are these communities in the rural areas, are they able to buy or even maintain an imported pump on a deep well? Is it realistic to ask small communities with just a few people to maintain expensive imported pumps? We're looking at communities less than 50, with less than 50 people. So the answer is actually given by Sally Sutton, WSP, UNICEF and SCOT in 2015. In this graphic, they calculated how much it would cost to implement a pump for 100 users, for example. If we implement a pump for 100 users, that would mean we have to invest $180 per person. But we said the population density might be 50 people per square kilometer or less. So let's look at 50 users per pump. Then the price goes up to $370 per person. Now, I'm not sure who is going to invest this kind of money. But I think we have to look at a different approach to reach these people. Now, this is a picture of an average village somewhere in Africa. Could have been taken anywhere. But what did we learn from this picture about sustainability? We see on this picture a pump. And we see also in this picture an ox cart, which is nicely put under a shed to be protected from sunlight and from rain. Now the pump is not functioning. It's imported from India. It's community owned. And the water should only be used for domestic use, for the household. Because it's a community thing. You can't water your garden with it. You can't feed your cattle with it. No, the donor has said this is for your household. Manage it with the entire community. Now the ox cart is a different approach. And the ox cart is functioning because it's an affordable thing. It was made somewhere by a local welder using local materials. Old tire, car tires, timbers which are available, steel that is available. The ox cart is privately owned. It's just bought by one family. And that family uses that ox cart to bring the vegetables to the market every week. So the ox cart is generating income for that family. Now, so what can we learn about functionality in these two settings? I'll come back to that later. Let me first talk a little bit about what we are doing. As a smart center in Zambia, we are training entrepreneurs how to provide water solutions. For example, here these are drillers who have learned how to make pumps. The technologies that we're teaching them should be simple. This is one way of drilling. It should be market-based. There should be a market for that technology. It should be affordable, so people can also repair these technologies. That's where the word SMART stands for. Simple, market-based, affordable, repairable technologies. SMART Center. We do that to make sure that people can buy the pumps and the boreholes themselves. without the need of any subsidy. I'm not saying that everybody should be able to buy a borehole. Some of the people should be able to buy these pumps direct. So there is always a market for these trained entrepreneurs. And we call that self-supply, not waiting for subsidy. So it also means we have to use local materials. We have to make sure everything can be produced locally. Not only the pumps, but also the drilling sets and the boreholes. So we use manual drilling because in our area we have seen that many Handak wells, they run dry in the dry season after 6 months of no rain. So we provide a technology that can drill deeper into the water table. And everything should be profit-based, meaning that these entrepreneurs should be able to make a profit. Because when they make a profit, well, then we know that these technologies, these entrepreneurs will continue their work after the project stops. Now let's come back to the picture, what we have learned from that picture, remember about functionality. Let's say, just like the ox cart, we provide a pump to a family. We make sure it's affordable, it's privately owned, it generates income. If a pump is affordable, it can be repaired. If it's privately owned, there's no discussion about who should repair it. If it generates income, we're sure it's going to be repaired. Now, we've implemented 50 of them in 1 year, and we've learned that the water from these pumps, although they are privately owned, the water is still shared for domestic use with 10 neighbors. And they even don't charge anything, because there's no African in rural Africa who says, this is my pump, you can't use that water for drinking. No, everybody will say, no, just share, take the water you need, as long as I can use it also for my garden. And that garden income is making sure the pump is maintained by this person. So we call that privately owned and community served. Although the pump is private, we're still providing water for the entire community. Because 10 families is about 50 people, isn't it? Now, our president seems to like that, but more important is the person here at the back, this one, because that person has an income helping this farmer to grow his business. So we are not only providing water, we also boosting the rural economies, there where it's needed the most. We have talked about entrepreneurs who produce water solutions. Now let's talk about the other entrepreneurs who use that water. We, as a smart center, we provide business training. We make sure that the pumps are privately owned and that they use it to generate an income. You can make bricks or blocks or do a vegetable garden or do chicken or feed your cows, as long as it generates income. And we promote diversity. Not everybody should do tomatoes. Now, why are we focusing on entrepreneurs? Because the entrepreneurs are the role models. They escape poverty by their own power, by their own work. And they are visible on the markets because they're selling their products. Then I'm sure they'll also be role models. They will inspire others to do something similar. But also they create the jobs, because not everybody has the skill set to be an entrepreneur. So there should be people who also create the employment. And after we leave, they will continue using their knowledge and their equipment, because it provides income for them. Now, there's no magic. We also have our limitations. For example, we can't drill deeper than 14 meters. If the water's deeper than 14 meters, and 35 meters, let's say, then we have a problem. We can't reach with our technology. And if we hit a very big rocky layer, and then also we have to stop. I mean, our drilling technologies is driven by manpower, not by a big machine. But the trained drillers promise that once they go to a site and the first attempt they don't reach water, they will always do a second attempt for free. But again, there's limitations. Now, luckily, in Zambia, UNICEF mapped where the manual drilling is possible and where it's not possible. So looking at this map, all the blue areas and the green areas, they're suitable for manual drilling. The yellow areas, they're limited suitable for manual drilling. And the red areas, they are not suitable for manual drilling. But our smart center is located here, where we train people in the yellow area about manual drilling. So if they are succeeding at our place, then we know they can cover quite a bit of Zambia with their technology. Now, let's look at the results after 1 year. After 1 year, the Smart Center in Zambia trained 7 welders and 8 drillers. And in that 1 year, they installed 54 pumps and they served 2,700 people. Now in this map, which is on the website www.terkana.help/mwater, where we monitor all our pumps, this map shows the pumps that are privately bought without any sponsorship. They are dark dotted, the dark blue. And it shows also the pumps that are privately sponsored, because we have to show people that the technology is working. Word of mouth is the most important piece of marketing in Africa. So we have to show people that the technology is working. And then you see that people start to buy the things for themselves. Now, what is interesting, what we've also learned is that we see in the self-supply column here, these are the people who buy the pumps directly without any sponsorship, that even though the drilled boreholes are, the new drilled boreholes are much more expensive, they opt for that already. Half of the pumps which are installed are actually installed on the manually drilled borehole. And that was also a surprise for us. Now this graphic shows the partly sponsored pumps in time. So it shows that in 1 year, 37 pumps were partly sponsored. And the dark blue line shows that the self-supply pumps, meaning the pumps that have been bought without any sponsorship. And if we would stop the sponsor program after 1 year, then this is what would happen. The self-supply pumps would continue growing, meaning that the output of the program will continue growing, even though we don't put any money into it anymore. I'm not saying that we should stop sponsoring at all, because in very rural areas, people still have little money, and I think it's only fair to help them a little bit with the sponsorship. Anyway, thank you very much. This is my story for now. If you have any questions, go to our website www.jarkana.help and feel free. There's a lot of resources there. All the manuals are for free. Training materials, videos about how to drill and how to make pumps is available there. I hope to see you soon. Thank you very much. Bye.